narrative of God's interaction with humankind, and we see his miraculous touch in people's lives. In fact, when you want to talk about a miracle from the Bible, it's difficult to focus on just one. The Bible does help us, however. In Hebrews chapter 11, you find a collection of references to God's intervention and the faith of God's people. So this morning, we're going to talk about Hebrews 11. Some people call it the Hall of Faith. You know, it's intimidating to walk through the Hall of Faith. Sometimes I feel like a little kid wearing sneakers and a ball cap with a wad of bubble gum in my cheek, looking around at the great heroes of the faith and feeling so unqualified. If you don't get into that, maybe you have to think about how you would feel if you went to the Pro Football Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio, near where I grew up. You know, I remember going there a few times when I was a kid, and you're there and you're watching the film clips. You see the statue of Jim Thorpe. You see these great film clips. You read the statistics, read the posters, see the, you know, retired numbers of the uniforms hanging there, and you go through this entire inspiring display, and you feel like this at the end: I have no business ever picking up a football again. To throw it makes me look like a fool. These are the greatest athletes in football history. Well, sometimes we feel that way in the Hall of Faith. I mean, let's face it. People like Moses and Joshua and Sarah and Abraham and Enoch and a host of others, they intimidate us. In fact, for our text today, we're going to look at just one small passage from Hebrews chapter 11. And I want you to turn with me to verse 29 and 30. It was by faith that the people of Israel went right through the Red Sea as though they were on dry ground. But when the Egyptians tried to follow, they were all drowned. It was by faith that the people of Israel marched around Jericho for 7 days, and the walls came crashing down. Now, this message today is going to be based on three simple truths. You'll actually be able to walk away and remember these three simple truths. The first is that people are people. We have a tendency to think that God's family is divided into ordinary people and super saints. And we think, well, we're not one of the super saints like those described in the Bible. But what the Bible wants us to know is that all of us, everyone who walks the earth, is just POH, plain old human. And the second thing we're going to talk about today is that God is God. People are people, but God is God. He wasn't more God in Bible times than he is today. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he still helps us through our greatest pain and difficulties today as he did back then. And the third thing we're going to mention is that miracles are miracles. We live in a time when people think they can explain away the miracles of the Bible, like when Jesus told the disciples to cast their net on the other side of the boat. Sophisticated minds say, well, you know, he probably saw the school of fish on the other side. Or when Jesus fed the 5,000, those who want to dismiss the miracles say, well, you know, everyone had food in their tunics. And they were inspired by the little child's sacrificial gift that caused all of them to say, well, okay, and to take their food out and to share it with their neighbor. That's what they say. But no, I want to say to you, you cannot explain away the miracles of the Bible. The truth is, miracles are rare, but they do happen. Now, we're talking about miracles, and I think it would be fitting for us to just take a minute and look at a definition of a miracle. You can go through commentaries on all kinds of things, but this is our working definition for today. A miracle is a humanly impossible event that occurs in the natural realm apart from natural causes for the glory of God. It's humanly impossible. It occurs in the natural realm in which we live apart from natural causes, and it's for one purpose, for the glory of God. So let's dive in. This first thing that I mentioned is that people are people and nothing more. That's right. I want you to understand that all of us have the same tendencies that even the people of Israel did, who I mentioned in our text. As a matter of fact, let's focus for just a moment on the word they in the text and the people in the text. It says, they went right through the Red Sea as though they were on dry ground. Who is this they? Who are these folks? And they, by faith, the people of Israel, the people of Israel. It's not just Joshua alone, not just the trumpeters alone, but the people of Israel walked around Jericho. Who are these folks? Well, let's go back to the Exodus text to remember that miracle. You remember that they escaped Egypt, where they were being held as slaves, and they were not long departed when Pharaoh realized that his economy was going to greatly suffer because they lost the greatest workforce that the Egyptian economy had ever known, and those people worked for free. And so he sent his army after them. And here were the people of Israel. I mean, masses and throngs of people who had escaped from Egypt, and they're making their way toward where Moses was leading them, and here they are, hemmed in by mountains on one side, by desert on another, and boxed in by a body of water in front of them. When we see that, we have to recognize, the scripture says, as Pharaoh drew near, they became frightened. There's that they again. They cried out to God, just as we do when we're troubled or frightened or concerned. And they also blamed their leader with accusations. And so we open the scripture, and here's what you see. The they that is being talked about, you see panic, you see complaint, you see doubt, you see blame, you see second guessing, and you see fear. So how's that for the heroes of the faith? You see, Moses, we know from the earlier account of Moses, when God met him at that burning bush, he tried to get out of the assignment. He even said to God, you know that I stutter. And I imagine if anyone had problems with stuttering, he certainly would have at this moment, when you see the clouds of dust and hear the chariot wheels coming toward you, and Moses stood up before the people and probably said something like this, don't fear. And I would say the same thing the same way, and I don't even stutter. But I would then, because it's a fearful sight. But notice, the people are people, nothing more. They have fears, they have blame, they have complaint. It maybe makes you feel a little better when you realize, okay, God does miracles in spite of the people. We're not the hall of faith, the great angelic beings with halos and wings. We're ordinary people, as I said, just plain old human. Now we come to the second part of the message, which is God is God. Let's go back to the text in Exodus chapter 14 and just follow along as I read these couple of verses. But Moses told the people, don't be afraid. Let's just pause here for just a second. When Moses said, "Don't be afraid," do you think that all the masses of people went, "Oh, okay"? No, I'm thinking about, you know, if I was standing on the edge of a bridge getting ready for a bungee jump, which I would never willingly do anyhow, but if I was standing there and I'm just trembling and somebody walks up to me and says, "Don't be afraid," I'd push them over the bridge. I mean, I would be so afraid. So just those three words, "don't be afraid," that doesn't mean you're not going to be afraid. Okay, back to the text. Moses told the people, "Don't be afraid, just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians who you see today will never be seen again. The Lord Himself will fight for you. Just stay calm." Then here's the miracle. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving. Pick up your staff and raise your hand over the sea. Divide the water so the Israelites can walk through the middle of the sea on dry ground." Now there's a miracle. Walking through a seabed on dry ground, maybe even kicking up clods of dust. How does that happen? Because God divided the sea, and there's no other explanation. The people walked on dry ground, and when you read it over and over, that dry ground is the descriptor of what God did. The water, the Bible says, stood up like a wall. Now, we all know water can't stand up like a wall. And if you can just get Cecil B. DeMille's movie out of your head for just a minute, I just want you to think, God did a miracle that defies explanation for His glory. A miracle. Verse 24, "Then God instructed Moses again to stretch out his hand after the people had come through." And now the Egyptians are in the middle of the... You read the scripture. It says that confusion came over them. Their wheels began to wobble in the soft bed of that dry ground in the seabed. And as confusion and panic began to encroach upon them, one of them yelled, "Let's get out of here for fighting for them." And then Moses stretched out his hand, and the entire Egyptian army was annihilated. Moses was involved, but God did the miracle. So what are you facing? Maybe you feel like there's no way out of your current situation. You need to be reminded, and I need to be reminded, of these scriptures on a regular basis. When you read the story of how God delivers His people through the sea, your faith is strengthened. We all need to be reminded. You know, being reminded is just a part of our faith. That's why Jesus said about the Lord's Supper, "As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Oh, how prone we are to forgetting. Anybody with me? Raise your hand, say, "I'm prone to forgetting." I'm the preacher. I'm prone to forgetting. I need to read the scripture. I need to be reminded that God is God and nothing less. And the third part of this message is miracles are miracles, nothing else. Nothing else. Now, in one verse from these Hebrew words that we read from Hebrews 11, in one verse, we jump ahead 40 years. To the fall of Jericho. Don't forget the background of this miracle. You see, a whole generation of Hebrews had died off. Why? Well, one time they had actually come to the brink of going to the promised land, but they would not receive the promise. They were afraid. Now, you would think that these people would have caught on by now. I mean, parting of the Red Sea, being fed from manna from heaven, water from the rock, being fed the quail, and on God's protection, their sandals didn't wear out. I could go on, and that's just a short list of all of the ways that God cared for the people. And now they got to the brink of the Jordan River to cross to the promised land, and they were afraid. They sent the spies in. The spies came back, and the people said, we can't do it. It's impossible for us. And so God allowed them to wander another generation in the wilderness until now. You have to look back and say, you know, when Hansel and Gretel left a bread trail, the trail behind the Hebrew people were fresh graves of a whole generation dying off. Imagine how many funerals Moses and Caleb and Joshua must have conducted as they saw that generation pass away. Now an untried leader is at the helm. His name is Joshua. But take off the halo and the wings. He's just a POH, plain old human. He has never seen walls fall before. He doesn't know what's about to happen. And that's why we turn to this text from Joshua chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. Look at it. Now Jericho was tightly shut up because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. And then the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men." Now, God said, "See." And I think Joshua probably said, "See what?" Here are 30-foot thick, impenetrable walls, higher than our sanctuary. "See what? You've delivered this into my hands?" And then God instructs Joshua to tell the people, "Toss away your spears and your arrows. You're not going to need those. Instead, line up behind the priests who are going to blow the trumpets, the ram's horn trumpets, every day. And you're going to march around these walls." And there's one more instruction. "Do not speak. Walk in silence." Now, as a longtime pastor, I can tell you that's almost impossible to get a group of people to not speak. Come on. But that was the instruction. Don't speak. Now, when you read the scripture, you realize that for 6 days they marched around the wall. The ram's horn trumpets were blowing. They're not speaking. But the scripture says they stopped at night, that every morning they resumed. And can't you just see this soldier writing a letter home at night? "This army is the dumbest thing I've ever been a part of. I mean, who could think that we'll ever conquer a city by silently marching around the walls day after day? I don't know what gets into our commander, but this is idiotic." On the seventh day, they marched around the walls 7 times. You may say, how could they do that? A whole city. Well, I did a little bit of research and I realized that the city of Jericho was very, very compact, and while thousands of people lived there, you could actually put the whole city onto the property of Hope that Hope owns here, the 20 acres. And so it wouldn't be too hard to walk all the way around it in a day. And it's not impossible to walk all the way around it 7 times in a day. And then the scripture says, at the long blast of the trumpets, you're to set up a battle cry. And so they did. And to everyone's astonishment, the walls and the earth began to tremble, and the walls came tumbling down, as the old song says. A miracle. A miracle is a miracle, nothing else. Physically, it's impossible, but it happened. When I think of Jericho, I think of some of the walls that people are facing, walls of resentment and bitterness, hemming them in, walls of habits that cannot be overcome, walls that have you hemmed in and you just don't know what to do, frustration and lack of direction, and you're just kind of in those walls. And you need a miracle. So I'm going to turn the corner, and I want to share with you my personal testimony about some lessons I've learned about trusting in God. You know, one of the advantages of getting older, there are a few, I don't have any teenagers at home anymore. Hallelujah, you know. And I have 8 grandchildren instead. That's fun. But one of the advantages as a pastor in getting older is you learn some lessons about trusting God along the way. And I want to share with you 4 things. These are not from some commentary. This is just my personal experience. Number 1, give the situation to God in prayer. You know what? I found an interesting exercise in so doing, in praying. I put my hands out like this as if the situation or the concern, I'm handing it to God. You know why that's important? Because the next day when I start worrying about it again, I can hand it again. And the next day I can hand it again until finally I convinced myself that it is not my place to hold this concern, but to give it to God in prayer. Prayer is mighty. Prayer is powerful. Prayer is our most untapped resource as the believers in Jesus Christ. The second thing I've learned is to trust in God to provide a solution. Oh, I come up with lots of solutions. I tell God exactly how He should solve every dilemma. But you know something? I've learned to trust in God. On one side, I've learned that there is a tendency to fear and anxiety and worry and alarm and even doubt. You know what I've learned? When I trust God for the solution, on the other side, I found relief and calm and gratitude and celebration. And one more thing, often a tinge of guilt that I didn't trust God more at the beginning. Can anybody relate to that? There's a third thing I've learned along the way, which is to open your eyes to God's provision in unexpected ways. Now, that last 3 words, in unexpected ways, is what makes it different from point number 2. I've learned to open my eyes, which means, Lord, wake me up. Help me to see that You are already at work to provide for this need. In unexpected ways is again to say God meets needs in ways beyond what I typically expect that He will do. As a matter of fact, there are very few times that God does exactly what I think He ought to do. Can you say amen to that? Amen. And the 4th thing that I've learned, and this is the most important, I think, of it all, is give glory to God instead of human explanations. Give the glory to God instead of human expectations. You know, our human explanations always discount what God's done. I've been in situations, and time doesn't allow, but I've been in situations where someone starts to glorify God and then another person in the group says, yeah, but that really happened because this and this and this came our way. But that's the whole point. God caused it. God made it happen. Let's not live in human explanations. Let's understand that God does it. So when you need a miracle, I want to tell you about the miracle you've already received. When you need a miracle, choose the resurrection of Jesus Christ and bask in it, because it's the promise of victory for every one of us. You see, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have eternal life. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, when you believe on Him, there's nothing that can happen to you. Even if your life itself is taken, you are the victor because you will be with Him forever. You see, that's the greatest miracle of all. There are people here who are listening to me, and I do not want to minimize anyone's pain or suffering, but there are people here hoping that we have a cure for cancer. But I want you to know the cure for cancer is not another chemical. The cure for cancer is the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the promise to us that even though every one of us, the Bible says, it is appointed to everyone once to die, and we don't all go out the same way. Some of us go out by disease, some by accident. some by heart problems, but one thing is sure. The gospel of Jesus Christ is our miracle. It's our hope. It's our promise. It's our eternal life. Hope Church needs a miracle. I have sent a letter this last week to every home describing that we have a financial need. And this is my approach. Number one, it's a responsibility that I have as your pastor, because I don't want to face you where you say, well, why didn't you tell us we had a need? So I told you, and I explained it the best way I could. But secondly, I wanted to help you understand that meeting the need is actually achievable as we work on it together through the SHARES program. It's a way. It's one way. But there's a third thing, and I think this is what God really has in mind. He said, I want to ask you as Hope Church to learn to depend on me. Really depend upon me. So we're going to close our service today with a time of prayer, a time of anointing. I want you to feel free to come forward if you would like to come forward to pray for our church, that God will increase our witness in this community, that He'll strengthen our ability to meet the needs of others, that He'll provide the resources that are necessary to carry on this ministry, to ask God to help us. You may want to come forward and pray for personal needs, and deacons and deaconesses are going to gather over here by where it says Jesus is the subject, and they'll anoint you and pray for your personal needs. But in this end of this moment, let's not hurry. Let's not put a clock on God, but let's let God work in our lives and in our church. Let me lead us in prayer as we prepare for this sacred time. It is true, Lord, that the Bibles we hold in our hands are anthologies of your work in human life and experience, just full of miracles and divine help in human need. In this moment right now, we recognize that you have given us the promise of the resurrection, and you will see us through the very tough times of our lives as well. I pray, Father, for everyone who needs the encouragement of your Spirit and needs your touch, that they'll have the courage to come forward for prayer. I pray for Hope Church. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you will help us not to live in fear or complaint, but to live in absolute trust of you. Let this sacred prayer time that we're about to have be a moment when you move mightily in our midst. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.